In 1820, French astronomer Alexis Bouvard noticed something strange. The gravity of the inner planets couldn't account for the orbital movement of the outermost planet, Uranus. His hypothesis? There must be a massive object influencing it. That eventually led mathematicians to correctly calculate the location of our eighth planet, Neptune. And this discovery fueled a mad hunt to discover more planets using this method.
To give it an approximation, everybody and their brother have looked for planets beyond Neptune. I mean, the moment Neptune was discovered, everyone wanted to do it because it was this clear demonstration that you can use math to discover objects.
Unfortunately, since then, no major planet in our solar system has been found. But thanks to modern telescopes, thousands of smaller objects have been discovered in the past few decades beyond Neptune, called trans-Neptunian objects, or TNOs, like Sedna, one nicknamed the Goblin, and another nicknamed Biden. And planetary scientists at the California Institute of Technology have noticed some anomalies with these objects.
The first is the fact that the orbits all lie in the same plane. The second is that they all swing out into the same direction. Now, the third is where it gets interesting. A large fraction of these orbits that swing out and to look like they've been arranged are detached from the orbit of Neptune.
Their hypothesis? A giant theoretical planet beyond Neptune, which accounts for the anomalies of these objects, Planet 9. And thanks to a new telescope, equipped with the largest digital camera ever built, we may be one sky survey away from finally finding it.
It will be a game changer because it's big and it can detect very faint objects. We will find objects all the way from near-Earth asteroids out to trans-Neptunian objects and beyond.
After the discovery of Neptune, scientists thought there had to be yet another planet to account for the remaining orbital anomalies of Uranus. They called it Planet X. There were hundreds of attempts by scientists to find this missing planet over the next few decades. But as it turns out, they were wrong. Astronomers had incorrectly estimated Neptune's mass, later confirmed by Voyager in 1989, which did account for these remaining anomalies.
The reason Pluto was initially considered a planet is because it was an object that was sort of in the right part of the sky where Clyde Tombaugh was looking for Planet X, a predicted object that was supposed to resolve remaining orbital anomalies of Uranus.
Although Pluto would later be classified as a dwarf planet, since it was too small and too far away to have any influence on the outer planets, this was the start of a new era for discoveries of bodies in the outer solar system. Pluto is one of what's thought to be hundreds of thousands of TNOs. And the more that are discovered, the more data seems to point to a ninth planet.
We see this grouping of trajectories, all these little pieces of debris that are hanging out in this population of icy planetesimals beyond Neptune, all of their orbits tend to be aligned in a very specific way that is difficult to ascribe to chance or to describe in any other way other than the existence of yet another planetary mass body hanging out in the distant solar system.
The aligned orbits hint at a large body pulling them in the same direction. They also found each TNO to be tilted on its axis in approximately the same way. And they don't appear to be put there by Neptune.
These orbits should all hug the orbit of Neptune, and many of them don't. Why not? Well, Planet 9 once again comes in back into the fold. You need Planet 9's gravity, as it turns out, to kind of untether these objects from the orbit of Neptune.
There's other circumstantial evidence as well. If you compare the sizes of discovered exoplanets, planets outside our solar system, the majority fall into categories known as super-Earths or mini-Neptunes.
On average, each star, if you look up in the night sky, has at least one planet. And most planets that inhabit this galaxy, if you will, are super-Earths, these objects that are a few Earth masses. It's actually quite remarkable that the solar system, as efficient as it was at creating planets, appears to be missing these short-period super-Earth-type objects, which are very common elsewhere.
So if Planet 9 does exist and is super-Earth size, it would make our solar system similar to the majority we've observed. To make all these calculations, and determine the potential orbit of Planet 9, the team at Caltech put collected data into computer simulations.
As far as the math allows us to calculate, it's about 5 Earth masses. Okay, so it falls in between an Earth-type planet and an ice giant such as Uranus or Neptune.
They also estimate that it's on a 20,000-year orbit around the Sun. That's 10 times further away than Neptune is from the Sun.
We can calculate the orbit and the mass of Planet 9 to a pretty good approximation. What we cannot do is tell you where it is on the night sky. Fundamentally, it's all just gravity. It's a different type of dynamics, okay, which allows us to infer the existence of Planet 9 than was the case with Neptune. With Neptune, you could say it's right there and get the orbit kind of wrong. Here, you have information about the orbit, not so much the information of where it is on the night sky, so that's why we're stuck kind of observing a whole swath of the sky, which takes a long time, is indeed difficult to do.
That massive swath of sky makes finding such a faint, faraway object like finding a needle in a haystack.
Planet 9 is millions of times less bright on the night sky than Neptune. That's really, really dim. I mean, if you really think about it, Neptune is not something you can observe with your naked eye. You need a telescope to see, and Planet 9 is millions of times less bright.
Critics say that the team at Caltech have an observational bias, having not looked in enough quadrants of the sky at different times of year to conclude that there is in fact orbital clustering. Essentially, more data is needed.
The good news is we are kind of entering the next generation of such surveys now with the commissioning and the construction of the Vera Rubin telescope in Chile. So I think that's going to be a game changer in this problem.
The Vera Rubin Observatory is a new telescope that'll be coming online in the next couple of years to complete the widest, most detailed survey of the sky ever conducted. This Legacy Survey of Space and Time, or LSST, may finally tell us once and for all if Planet 9 is out there.
Reuben Observatory is a next-generation survey telescope that is set to observe the entire night sky every few nights, repeatedly for 10 years. The idea being we can build up not only a deep image of the sky, but also a multicolor movie.
Unlike telescopes like the Hubble Space Telescope, the Reuben Observatory's field of view is extremely wide. And thanks to its giant 3-gigapixel camera, which is the size of a small car, it can also detect incredibly faint objects lurking in the outer regions of the solar system. So then narrow field of view telescopes like Hubble can take a closer look.
Because it's a survey telescope, we have a plan to go and do this survey across the night sky, but then also process all the images and reduce those to catalogs so that astronomers can come along and then they can look at the catalogs and they can do searches for unusual objects or things that match what they're looking for just using the catalogs that we're producing.
That'll help scientists solve the mysteries of dark matter, dark energy, map the Milky Way, and inventory moving objects throughout the solar system like TNOs.
So, for example, in the solar system, almost every population of object that you can think of in the solar system, we will detect about 10 to 100 times more of. We will take 2 million images over 10 years, which is actually 4 million actual pictures of the night sky. So each image is 3.2 gigapixels, and we take about 1,600 images per night. That's about 20 terabytes of data per night.
To find objects within our solar system, the telescope will take two images of every patch of sky, separated by an hour. And from the motion of the points of light over that hour, they'll be able to distinguish between faint stars and objects within our own solar system. That's a problem for Planet 9, though. Objects that are far beyond Neptune will be difficult to detect from the motion of only an hour. Another problem is Planet 9 may be in the Northern Hemisphere sky. Due to the frequent clear skies and low light pollution, Reuben Observatory is strategically located below the equator in Chile and will mostly see Southern Hemisphere skies. But if it is there, Reuben Observatory is equipped to find it.
I have colleagues who believe in Planet 9, and I have colleagues who don't believe in Planet 9. It's really hard to say definitively that it's out there. We have to go and look. So one of the things that LSST can do is actually contribute by surveying more of the sky. So people are already looking for Planet 9, but given the fact that you have to look at a large amount of sky and you need to look for very faint kind of objects, that's kind of can be a slow process. So LSST will be able to do that much more quickly. So within the first year of surveying the sky, LSST could see if there was a Planet 9 within its survey footprint down to the magnitudes that we can see. The other thing, though, that we can do is provide further constraints on what the orbit could be, because a lot of the constraints so far come from these also relatively rare, very distant objects, and we'll find a lot more of those too. We'll also be able to tell if it really is just a bias in the observing data.
Even if the planet isn't found, it may give astronomers more data to find it during future surveys. Or it may show that there are other explanations for the orbits and tilts of these TNOs, as some scientists have argued. Either way, a hunt to find Planet 9 will undoubtedly lead to the location of new, undiscovered TNOs and whatever else is in our neighborhood.
From the perspective of daily life, no one's gonna change their daily habits, you know, start brushing their teeth more or whatever, you know, because there's a planet hundreds of times this as far away from the sun as is the Earth. But at the same time, look, I mean, it is part of human nature to explore, right? It is part of human nature to ask the question, what's out there? What lies beyond the ocean? What lies beyond this hill? What lies beyond this planet? What lies beyond the edge of the solar system? There's something deeply satisfying about asking and answering these questions that I think is really important to kind of our collective human experience.